In Tulsa, the racial and economic disparities that we see today is a direct result of the 1921 Tulsa Race Massacre. Those are not my words. Those are the words of the current mayor of Tulsa, G.T. Bynum. And these disparities that we all know exist, some of these disparities, if you've already heard, is that we live 11 to 14 years less than our white counterparts in South Tulsa because we have no health care. We have no hospital. North Tulsa, Black Tulsa is where I live, where I grew up. I'm a son of Greenwood, a proud product of North Tulsa. We have no hospital. We're shot and beaten by the police 3 to 4 times more than our white counterparts in Tulsa. We have 35% of our people, Black people in Tulsa, living in poverty. We own our homes 2.5 times less in Tulsa, Blacks, than white Tulsans. We have evidence after statistic after statistic. Yet, our mayor, our city, our county, our chamber, they oppose justice. They oppose reparations. They oppose Mother Randall, Mother Fletcher, and Mr. Ellis, who you heard from today. I am here today because the city of Tulsa has failed us. They bombed us. They burnt us. They killed us. They looted from us. They destroyed not just our property, not just our livelihood and our lives, but our legacy, our generational wealth, the idea of Greenwood, a freedom mind state, land ownership, and wealth concentration. They took that from us. And then they put in a system of policy violence that continues to this very day. So much so that right now, as I speak, the same perpetrators of the massacre, the city, the county, the chamber, the state, are utilizing the massacre to pad their own pockets. They're utilizing the branding of the massacre, the narratives, the names, and the likenesses of people who suffered, who died, who was treated as refugees, who lived in internment camps for 18 months, who had to be signed out by a white person with an ID card. These people who have raised more than $30 million in the name of the massacre for what they call cultural tourism. Not one penny has been given to any of the survivors. Not one dime has been paid for the claims that are still outstanding. The claims that these sophisticated, wealthy Black people had the wherewithal, the savviness to have insurance policies. Over 1,400 claims remain today, over $50 million. We know who's owed this money. We know who made the claims. We know where they lived. We know what was taken. We also even know some of the insurance companies that are still active today. I want to give you their names. CNA, AIG Companies, the Insurance Company of Pennsylvania, Westchester Fire Insurance Company, the Hartford, Great American Insurance Company, Insurance Company of North America, North River Insurance Company, California Insurance Company, Phoenix Assurance Company. We have reached out to these folks, asking them to engage in a conversation on how they can directly benefit those who they failed 100 years ago. And just like the city has refused, just like the state has refused, just like the chamber has refused, we have not gotten the insurance companies to engage in a meaningful discussion with us at this time. The banks failed us. Thousands of the survivors of Greenwood lost their life savings in the banks because their bank books burnt up and they couldn't get their money out. And we've researched and found at least 17 of those banks we believe are still operating through Chase and Bank of Oklahoma. We want a conversation with them also. The courts failed us. There's been over 100 lawsuits filed on this issue. And not one has been heard on its merits. You heard from my clients. I have the great honor to serve as lead counsel. These three wonderful, amazing people you heard from today. We went through hell to get here. Mother Fletcher traveled yesterday from 6 a.m. in the morning, and we didn't get in to our hotel till after midnight. This woman didn't complain. This woman didn't have anything to eat. She said, I got to be here. I want to see justice. Representative Cohen, Representative Nadler, Representative Lee, I was here in 2007. I appreciate you still being with us. But as you know, we have lost so many since that hearing. Otis Clark, Dr. Olivia Hooker, John Hope Franklin. And even we've lost my great mentor, Charles Ogletree. He's not gone, but he's not with us. People who have fought. I'm literally standing on the shoulders of so much people who have suffered so long. We are coming to you. I am coming to you in the name of my community, my people, my clients, asking that you do for us what this Congress has done for the Japanese internment victims, what this Congress has done for the 9/11 terrorist victims. We're asking to be treated as full human beings. We're asked to be treated that it is the belief in America that Dred Scott is not the law of the land, that the black man does have rights that America must respect. And I know my time is getting low, but let me just finish with this. Hal Singer. Show you how powerful this issue is. Hal Singer was a world-renowned musician. He was a Greenwood survivor. He was dying over the last summer, 2020, in France. He moved from America because of racism. He had a stroke. He was blind. He was on hospice. Dying. I felt bad because I was communicating with his family. I said, you know what, maybe I should stop calling you guys because this time period. His wife admonished me. He said, are you crazy? Until he dies, Hal Singer is going to fight for justice for what happened to his parents and his community. And she sent me a letter that he wrote in 2007. And this is what he said. I've never had a lot of faith in the legal system for black men. That's why I moved to France. And I know we will lose a lot of battles. We must continue to fight for our rights and our dignity. I am here fighting for the rights and the dignity of Mother Fletcher, Mr. Ellis, Mother Randall, my community, and I'm asking you to help us fight, grant us legislation that pays restitution, gives us the ability to restore what was lost so we can rebuild for the next 100 years. Thank you.